you're seconds away from a head-on crash. Would you rather be in the tank-like 1990 Volvo, or do you opt for the newer 2012 Renault, but it's 500 pounds lighter? Place your bets now. If you chose the Volvo, you're in huge trouble. The seemingly tough metal structure was crushed. You're not walking away from this. Meanwhile, the little plastic Renault is far safer. The passenger compartment has barely been touched. How did that Volvo go from being the safest car of its era to losing to a tiny car? And more importantly, when does that happen to your vehicle? I needed to know, as my own car that had the highest safety ratings when I bought it was later revealed to have a deadly flaw that could kill me. Join me on my quest to figure out how car safety actually works and whether I need to say goodbye to my Honda Fit.
Is it hot? Ooh.
This video is brought to you by Proton. More of them later. To figure out how a car like mine or yours becomes dangerous, we need to go back in time when not much was known about auto safety. It's the 1950s, and cars are everywhere. And automotive deaths went from a blip to a major cause of death in 4 decades. Scientists were working hard at the first crash research centers. The tests were crude by today's standards, and the first safety designs, a little unconventional. But through trial, error, and a little bit of creativity, we started to unravel the deadly mysteries of car crashes.
Notice, at the moment of impact, the rim breaks away. This becomes a lethal instrument. It's a spear. That's what hurts the driver.
Engineers started solving these problems, and eventually those ideas became mature enough to be used in a production vehicle.
Because the 56 Ford has lifeguard design.
Ford's new lifeguard steering wheel is designed to cushion any impact against it. Even the shatter-resistant mirror is double-jointed to give way easily when hit.
Are you kidding me, Ford? We don't talk about safety. I don't care if this is the second best-selling car of the year. Get rid of it or we'll get rid of you.
Automakers were terrified the government would start asking questions and then create expensive and bothersome regulations. Next year, that car was never seen again, and with Ford put in place, automakers would focus on the fun of driving. These good times ended 1 decade later when the best-selling book, Unsafe at Any Speed, exposed the public and Congress in 1966 to how dangerous cars actually were. The government sprang into action, passing the first ever car safety bill. It's a game changer, forcing new tests on dangerous pieces of equipment. Failure means a car can't be sold. At the center of this safety revolution, the steering wheel. Today, when you're driving to work, you wouldn't think of this as a dangerous weapon, but let me show you what it used to be like. Did you catch it? The steering wheel rises up and smashes your face. And this is why. It used to be a spear, and the force of a crash pushes it forward and up into your face. To stop this, the government created a test. It crashed each new car, and to pass, the steering wheel had to move less than 5 inches. So how does a steel pole remain stiff while driving and soft on impact? Like this. By turning part of the shaft into mesh, it can easily collapse on impact to save your life. Today, steering wheels use these same principles, but it's a telescoping mechanism instead, as it's more reliable. If we look closely, it's a grooved metal sleeve that can slide over an inner core. At the bottom here is a U-joint, and it allows the column to be split into multiple sections, so in a crash, it'll fold up inside your car. The 1968 Act was a huge success, fixing tons of dangerous things in your car. But it had a major flaw. Car makers didn't need to prove their changes made you safer. They only had to tick the boxes on the equipment required. It's like making a cake with all the right ingredients, but not caring what it tastes like. So many cars remained incredibly dangerous despite the new law. To fix things, the government came up with a surprisingly clever idea. They introduced a 30 mile per hour crash test and placed a dummy inside to measure if you're safe or not. This shifted the focus from equipment to passenger protection. This new crash test meant all the parts had to work together for a car to pass, and the concept is known as crash worthiness, and it completely changed our ideas around making vehicles safe. In the same way, I think the idea of privacy is changing. It's not something I often consider until Proton revealed that my email provider collects a ton of data about my interests, my activity, who I connect with. I have my Google Nest, my Chromecast, my Android phone. Yep, my data profile is a valuable product to be sold for advertising. Today, these companies claim greater privacy, but what that means is that only they can exploit your data. The sponsor of this video, Proton, believes differently. They think no one should access your data. Their privacy and safety-focused email service gives you back control. Proton Mail encrypts everything and gives you the only keys to read it, which means that not even Proton staff can access your emails. This is called zero access encryption, and it means even if there's a data breach, your emails can't be read. Compare this to Yahoo, where a hack exposed 3 billion emails, which are used for identity theft and fraud. Also, the links and images you click on, those are often designed to track you and, worst case, hack you. Proton Mail strips those out automatically, so say goodbye to spam, phishing attacks, and spoofing. Proton and all their email servers are located in Switzerland, so you're protected by incredibly strong privacy laws. And it's easy to switch from your existing provider using the tool they built. Get started for free using the link in the description, proton.me/Andrew. It helps support the channel and be part of 100 million other users, including me, who have chosen privacy. Let's get back to the new crash test and the challenges it created. Automakers had a big problem to solve. Their cars were either too soft and crumpled like a tin can, or too rigid, and then this happened. Look at how hard you're thrown against your seatbelt. That snap can smush organs and break bones. The answer wasn't to make everything medium tough, but instead, they needed both soft and hard.
The first step was turning the passenger compartment into a fortress. The pillars, critical to this, had to be reinforced with multiple layers of steel to keep this area from being crushed. Engineers call this the safety cell. But without a cushion, a sudden stop would end up scrambling our internal organs, and I think we all like our internal organs. In your car, we get this cushioning by stretching out how long a crash takes. It's the difference between Wile E. Coyote and landing on a giant air-filled mattress.
To understand how, we need to look under the hood and talk about these structures here. Running along the front is a long and tough crash bar. This connects to a pair of crash rails. On impact, the bar squishes the rails like an accordion, and this motion absorbs more than half of the crash energy. This is part of the structure called a crumple zone, and there's one in the back to protect you in rear impacts.
Once crumple zones and safety cells became standard features, people were far more likely to survive. But there's a limit on how much they can protect you. To take safety to the next level, there needed to be a game changer, something with a little bit more oomph. Airbags were to be the next big thing. The technology was nearly mature by the late 80s, but standing in the way were a concerning number of serious injuries and even deaths.
Engineers found many passengers were too close to the airbag and their faces were smashed. Others weren't hitting the bag properly because they slid under the seatbelt. That's called submarining, and it could break your spine and damage organs.
So how does the government stop these injuries from happening? They took the same 30 mile per hour test, but made it harder by lowering how much force the dummy could receive. To pass this test, automakers needed not only airbags, but a whole symphony of new technology to stop the airbags from hurting you. And it starts with an explosive inside your seatbelt. Let's see what this does.
Watch the seatbelt closely. See how it tightens incredibly fast? This pulls back your chest so your face won't get smashed by the airbag. This also tightens against your pelvis so you can't slide under your seatbelt. These lifesavers are called pre-tensioners, and early versions in the 80s used a powerful spring to pull back the seatbelt.
But in the 90s and beyond, things got a lot more explosive. I have two types here. Let's set them off and see them in action.
I'm setting up a seatbelt retractor at the base of a chair. And inside is a pyrotechnic that will explode when it gets zapped by electricity, which winds up a mechanism inside along with the seatbelt.
When I trigger this, it's gonna go into here, and then Mr. Bear here will be saved by the explosion. I'm hoping this works. I've never done this before. We'll see what happens.
Oh, Wow, that scared the crap out of me. Holy crap. Okay, let's see. Let's go see. Oh, it smells like gunpowder. Have you ever smelled gunpowder before? That's the exact smell. Oh, jeez. This is probably burning hot to the touch too. I did not expect this to work at all. I'm so surprised.
I'm glad that worked. I also set up another pretensioner that's found in your buckle. This one is often paired with the one earlier for a stronger or an extended effect. All right, let's see what happens next.
The pretensioners are fired, pulling you back in the correct position. The impact pushes you forward again, and then this. Your seatbelt has locked, and that's because of a clever inertia-based mechanism inside that helps keep you restrained. However, to reach the airbag, you have to pull and stretch your webbing, which can cause some serious injury. To allow your body to move forward more gently, there's a device called a load limiter. It's in the middle of your seatbelt, and when you push forward hard enough, it twists a metal bar inside, which slowly releases the seatbelt, easing you forward into the airbag. Let's see how that goes.
All right, it's finally time, the big bang. I've been waiting to do this for a long time. I'm just kind of nervous. I don't know how this goes. I got a little bit of a tire barrier that I'm gonna hide behind right here. And if all goes well, then we'll see you on the other side.
Alright, I gotta open up the garage door, get some air in here. Apparently, it can be a little bit poisonous from this, so just wanna get a little bit of ventilation in here. Close the door so the neighbors won't call in.
Little did I know, that completely failed.
Are you okay?
Pardon?
Are you okay?
Yeah, sorry, was that really loud?
I closed this.
I'll put the rest of this conversation at the end of this video.
Still coming out, look at that. So those are the holes where the explosion comes out of. Look at that.
I was so happy it this worked, as there was a ton of planning that went into it. Afterwards, I went to the studio to do a teardown, but it didn't turn out to be that exciting. So let's wrap with this sequence, showing how everything comes together to reduce injuries from seatbelts and airbags, which includes some technology that reduces the impact if you blow through the airbag and smack the steering wheel.
Hopefully now you can appreciate how much goes into keeping you safe. And what an accomplishment by scientists and engineers. But it's not the government or automakers who are really giving the push on safety. I think in the last 25 years, this group has become the real leaders of car safety. Yep, car insurance companies. And many of you are alive today because of how they shamed automakers into making better cars. It sounds ridiculous until we learn why.
The reason? This. In 2023, insurance companies shelled out $96 billion in claims, with two-thirds of that going to bodily injury. Safer cars could save them tons of money, which is why in 1959, they came together and started their own research center, the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety, or the IHS. For decades, they were quietly working behind the scenes, but becoming unhappy with the slow pace of government, they had a brilliant idea.
What if we became the new safety standard instead of the government?
And in 1995, this started appearing on TVs across America.
Dateline has been reporting on a new kind of crash test. It's called an offset test, and some say it more closely resembles the way accidents occur in the real world.
And the results can be dramatically different. Remember that car in the government test? This is what happened to the same model car last year in the Institute's test. So you might wonder why the government doesn't do offset testing. We asked the government's top auto safety official that last year.
We applaud the Insurance Institute for doing this sort of test. We think it's an important test. We just don't have the money right now to do that.
In the mid-90s, this program was reaching over 20 million people a night. And this publicity was forcing automakers to respond to this new overlap test through expensive structural improvements.
All of these areas in yellow were designed and incorporated because of the offset test.
The biggest change was replacing mild steel used in the structure with advanced high-strength steel, which is five times stronger. This stronger steel and improved structure are the secret sauce as to why modern cars are safer. Remember how the lighter Renault won? It's because of ultra-high strength steel, which allowed the crash bar to distribute the hit across both rails in the vehicle. When the Volvo was hit, only one side worked, which is why you see this big dent in the front. This improvement is visible in the moderate overlap crash cores over time. After 18 years, every vehicle was acing this harder test. With this, the IHS knew they had a winning strategy. Design new and tougher tests, shame automakers with public spectacles, cars become safer, which saves them money, which funds new and harder tests. Game on. The government side impact test? Nope, that's not reflective of big American SUVs and what they do to smaller cars. So their bigger and tougher tests showed how heads would bounce off the hood. Automakers responded, and vehicles went from this to this. Test after test, this arms race in safety and publicity made the IHS the de facto standard in auto safety. Car makers were proud to earn the IHS's highest award, the top safety pick, which requires a good rating across the board to get it.
My Honda Fit had this, and it's a big reason why I bought this car. I was happy. Manual transmission, fun to drive, super practical. And then 1 year later, the IHS developed a new test and brought back previously safe cars like mine.
Surprise, surprise, many failed, including mine, as it avoids the usual crash structures and hits the driver's compartment directly. My car wasn't designed for this test, which is how it went from being safe to having a dangerous flaw overnight. Thanks, insurance companies.
But at least I know the issue, and it leads me to this. Is my Honda Fit dangerous? Do I need to say goodbye? The answer, of course, isn't straightforward, but I did find a resource that helped me make a decision. The IHS's Guide to Buying a Used Car for Teenage Drivers. Their good choice car, which is really just barely safe enough, requires a good rating for the moderate overlap, and a newer small overlap test isn't considered. This makes sense because the moderate overlap score has a higher impact in lowering the risk of serious injury and death. The IHS also sets a minimum weight of 2,750 pounds, as smaller cars below this have been shown to be way more deadly to drive if the safety technology is from the same era. Check out this crash test. My car loses against the heavier one from the same year and company. Heavier cars have more crash structure and their mass pushes into the smaller one more. So how does my car stack up? It has a good moderate overlap score. It's over the weight limit, and there's a few other factors it either meets or there's not enough information. For me, this means my car is borderline safe and I should upgrade it in the future. In the meantime, I've changed my habits to drive less. I walk around more and take public transit when I can't. There were a ton of engineering curiosities and details on how much the age and design of a car impacts risk that my story editor begged me to put in an article instead. So I'm launching a Substack, which is a WordPress newsletter platform that I'll put all my behind the scenes notes and videos in. You also only get an email whenever I have a new video, so I won't be spamming your inbox. Sign up below as the article won't be ready when this video is launched. If you like what you see here, subscribe to that, subscribe to my channel. Also consider Proton if you want a privacy focused email. I've already started using it to receive my medical documents. Thank you, see you in the next one.
Close the door so the neighbors won't call it.
Little did I know, that completely failed.
Are you okay?
Pardon?
Are you okay?
Yeah, sorry, was that really loud?
I closed this.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
What was it?
It was an airbag. From
oh my gosh.
Band. Don't breathe it in.
That's why I opened it. As soon as it came out, I'm like, oh, are you gonna need to ventilate this? Anyways, so sorry for...
Don't worry, there was nothing, you know.
Wow, so I'm disturbing the neighbors now? I think this is why some people hate YouTubers.